Today is the last part, inshallah, of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. And this part, my dear brothers, is very important. The life of the Prophet from the start to the end, especially from the time Allah sent him to spread the message till his death, is a must for everyone to know, and it's a lesson for us. The main important points about the seerah of the Prophet, first, number one, is that the hardship and the struggle that anyone will bear for Allah will give results. Allah says in the Quran, Fasbir, be patient. Inna al-aqibata lit-taqwa. تلك الدار الآخرة نجعلها للذين آمنوا لا يريدون علوا في الأرض ولا فسادا والعاقبة للمتقين. So all the time Allah tests the prophets. Allah did not give the prophets the means, the money, the power, the army, the material things, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the iman and the tawakkul and trust in Allah. And once they were patient, Allah destroys their enemy and give them at the end victory. Allah gave victory to Nuh 950 years. Can you imagine? 950 years, less than 80 people accepted Islam. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did to him at the end? Allah make the tufan. Tufan, scholar they said, is like you take a container of milk and you pour it, or water. This is how the sky fall, the water fall from the sky. And the earth blew with the rivers. And the whole system of the earth has been changed. And only this small group of people who accept Iman has been saved. So, my dear brothers, Allah tests us in this time also. Allah tests you to see where is your heart. If you fall in the trap of money and means, and makhluq and asbab, at the price of the orders of Allah, you break the orders of Allah to acquire these things, neither you are going to gain what you wish, nor you are going to please Allah. So you will lose both. You will lose your dunya, and you will lose your akhirah. And this is the real loss. And if you be patient and stick to the orders of Allah, no matter what. People, they said, we are in Canada. Anywhere you are, you have to stick to the orders of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open means of risk for you, halal, in this world. And He will be pleased for you for the hereafter. This is the real, brother, this is the key. This is the secret, this is the pin number. If you didn't reach the pin number, finish. You're lost. In both words, the pin number is the orders of Allah, no matter what. Never break the orders of Allah. So, we return back in very short, my dear brother, Rasulullah, once he prepared the environment in Medina, and as I said, Mus'ab ibn Umair, the Sahabi, the great da'i, the first messenger of Islam, the first da'i, the flattered boy, the boy who used to be very handsome, and when he passed through the street, the woman inside the rooms, they said, Mus'ab ibn Umair is passing by, and they watched from the window. This is in the Jahiliyyah. Very expensive perfume he put, nobody there buy it. He used to have important shoes from Hadramaut, far in Yemen. Very expensive shoes from the leather. And Na'l al-Hadrami in that time. Nobody could dare wake him up in the morning. And when he wake up, the food is served beside his head. But when he accepted Islam, Allahu Akbar, Sahaba, my dear brother, Allahu Akbar. You know, in every Sahaba, you made books about him. It's never finished. People, they said, one man, I hear him, he says, they are men, we are men. You compare yourself to Sahaba. No one will dare. You know, we are the dust. You see the dust that they step with their foot in it, in the path of Allah with Rasulullah, we will not reach that level. So my dear brothers, Mus'ab ibn Umair, in 1 year, I will just say in very short, I will talk very fast because it's very long and we want to finish. Mus'ab ibn Umair, he took the garden of Sa'd ibn Zurara. Sa'd ibn Zurara, he was one of the mean men, A'yan, leaders of the Ansar. And he gave him the garden, his garden. And he chose it as a musalla. And now, my dear brothers, he used to go with Sa'd ibn Zurara and they call people to the garden and he gave them da'wah. So when the people start accepting Islam and they start coming with him and they pray together, Usayd ibn Hudayr, the cousin of Sa'd ibn Mu'ad, they are the leaders of the tribe of Aus, they got extremely angry and they said, who is this man who divide our people and broke new religion? So Sa'd ibn Hudayr go with his soul to kill Mus'ab ibn Umair. So when he come and he says, speak loud, he says, you people are dividing our people, bringing a new man. Oh Sa'd ibn Zurara, if I don't know from my tribe, I will kill your guest. So then he tell him, Mus'ab ibn Umair smile to his face and tell him, leave the soul, come close, listen to what I'm telling you. If you accept, it's up to you. And if you don't accept, we will do exactly what you wish. We will move. And this is the wisdom of da'wah. So, because Mus'ab has yaqeen on what he said. This is our problem when we give da'wah. You have doubt. You have to have yaqeen that you have the truth. Mus'ab ibn Umair had yaqeen that these people will accept Islam if their heart has a talab, has a demand. So Usayd ibn Hudayr sat and he gave talk to him about Islam and he recited to him the Quran. Now, when we talk Quran here, You are reciting Quran in front of the master of the Arabic language. The masters, the Arabs, especially in the Jazeera, especially in Hijaz, they were masters. You know what does it mean, masters? He can make a poem of 1,000 bait in just 1 hour, seeing only one mashhad, one thing. He see it, he just do it. Perfect. He measurement of the words. There is no mistakes, there is no mistake in the voice. So he listened to the Quran. Now the Quran, my dear brothers, is a challenge. Quran. Arabs, when they hear the Quran, no one can say, this is from makhluk, this is fabricated. Because they know Arabic. So as soon as he recited to him the Quran, As'ad ibn Zurara, he says, I knew Islam in his face before he said it. Before he says, I'm willing to accept Islam, you can see that the iman penetrates in his heart. It shows in the face. So my dear brothers, he says, what to do if I want to become like you? He says, it's easy. You take a bath. This is not bath from the dirt. This is a bath from the shirk. You clean yourself from the shirk. And you repeat the shahada after me and you are Muslim. So then he accepted Islam and he tests the sweetness of Iman. And then he says, wait for me now, I'm going to bring you a man if he accepts Islam. Allah. If he accepts Islam, the whole Medina will be upside down. So he says, go bring him. So he went to Sa'd ibn Mu'ad. Sa'd ibn Mu'ad, my dear brothers, he was very tall and very heavy man, and he was positioned among the Ansar of Medina, like the position of Abu Bakr Siddiq among the Muhajirin. He was a very brave man, and no one can oppose his word, because he was very wise and he was the leader. So, Usayd ibn Hudayr, he came to him and told him, what did you do? And he was afraid to tell him that I accept Islam. He says, I could not convince them, you better go. So he gets extremely angry. He says, you did not please me. Sit down. You will see what I'm going to do. But Usayd ibn Hudayr did not tell him that I accept Islam. Why? Because he wants him to go. So Sa'd ibn Mu'ad, when he reached to the garden of Sa'd ibn Zurara, he said the same words and they answer him the same answer. Put your soul, come close. And listen, if you accept what we call people to, It's your luck. If you don't, we will move right away. He says, you did not say something. You are fair in your statement. He put the sword and he said. And when he recited to him the Quran, he says, عَرَفْنَا الْإِسْلَامَ فِي وَجْهِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَشْهَدَ بِالشَّهَدَتَيْنِ. We saw Islam in his face before he accepted Islam. Now listen to the effect of this man. Usayd ibn Hudayr, when he accepted Islam, he was quiet. Sa'd ibn Mu'ad, when he accepted Islam, tell them what to do to become like you. He said, you just take a bath, repeat after us, and you are Muslim. He don't know nothing about Islam. He don't know how to pray. He don't know how to make wudu. He don't know the ahkam. He don't know the halal haram. He just know that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. He went to his tribe, and he stand up, and he says, who I am among you? So they said, you are our leader, and son of our leader. He says to them, my food with you is haram. My sitting with you is haram. My talking to you is haram. Till you accept the deen of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they said, what is the deen of Muhammad? He said, you must say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. The whole tribe, in the same time, accepted Islam. Allahu Akbar. That's why my dear brother, this man, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, scholar, they said, he accepted Islam at the age of 32. He died at the age of 38. How many years in Islam? Six. But Allahu Akbar, 6 years in Islam. When he died, the throne of Allah shakes. His janazah has been witnessed by 70,000 angels. Rasulullah in his janazah, he was walking on his tiptoe by the big number of angels that witnessed this janazah of this man. Why? Because, my dear brothers, he is the one who led the Ansar to the sacrifice. The agreement was made in the Bay'at al-Aqaba that we will defend you from what we defend our wife and kids. It means inside the Medina. Allah doesn't want condition for his Jannah. Allah doesn't want condition. You cannot say, if Allah will give me, then I will do. Allah don't like that. Be careful. Listen to this. If you are called to spend or give time for the deen, never say, if Allah will give me, then I will. Allah don't like that. Allah wants you sacrifice, then he will give you. Allah says Quran, man atani shibran ataytuhu dirham. Whosoever will come to me by one arm, I will go to him by one hand. It means, and whosoever come to me walking, I'll come to him walking. So the condition, it means you should start. The start starts from you, not from Allah. Allah is ghani. Allah doesn't need you. So my dear brothers, the condition was that they will defend him in Medina. But the first test was, the fight was in Badr. Badr is 70 kilometers away from Medina. Badr is not inside Medina. Badr is 70 kilometers away. It's like you said, Hamilton from Toronto. This is where Badr. So, when the Ansar went with Rasulullah SAW, 313, Rasulullah SAW know that the Muhajirin, they are ready to die for the deen of Allah. But he says, what do you think? We are going to meet by coincidence with the army. We want the caravan. Now the caravan already escaped, and now the army of Quraysh are coming. What do you think? Three times. Umar Abu Bakr Siddiq is the first one to stand up, says, go ahead, O Prophet of Allah. We will fight them. Umar stand up, and Miqdad ibn al-Aswad. And Miqdad ibn al-Aswad is among the Muhajirin. How many kids we have now in our... Who has baby boy here? Who has baby boy? Raise your hand. Who is among you given name Miqdad? Who? Where is the name of Miqdad, brothers? Do you know who is Miqdad? These people, how we can talk to them? Miqdad, number 7 in Islam, from the time of Bilal. In the Khilafah of Uthman ibn Affan, he was over 80. And they said they put him in a container of wood and in the fat because he was extremely heavy when he gets old. And he says the meat is over his container and he says, take me out in the path of Allah. They told him, you are too old. You did what you can. He says, no. There is a verse in the Quran that does not give me an excuse. Infiru khifafan wa tiqala. Go in the path of Allah in all conditions. Al-Miqdad ibn al-Aswad, radiallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, Jannah, Jannah misses three people. Salman al-Farisi, Ali, four, Ammar ibn Yasir, and al-Miqdad, because they live longer. They live very long. Jannah, Jannah misses them. Can you imagine? So, al-Miqdad, he says, O Prophet of Allah, we will not tell you like Banu Israel told Musa, you go and your Lord, you fight, we are sitting here waiting. But we will tell you, go, you and your Lord, we are with you fighting. Now, Rasulullah repeat four times the same question. So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh is smart. When three among the Muhajirin stand up and they are ready to go, and he repeat the question, that means he mean the Ansar. Why he mean the Ansar? Because the agreement was, O Prophet of Allah, we will defend you from what we defend our wife and kids. We are not going to defend you outside. The first test was outside. Can you imagine? This is the Iman, my dear brothers. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh stand up and says, كَأَنَّكَ تُرِيدُنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. As if you mean us, O Prophet Allah, the Ansar. He says, yes. He says, O Prophet Allah, we make the agreement with you that we will defend you and you promise us Jannah. He says, take from our money whatever you want and leave whatever you want. By Allah, what you take is better in our heart than what you left. And do peace with whomsoever you want. And fight whomsoever you want. By Allah, none of us will be missing. Look, he's not making mashura with Ansar here. He is talking with one word, with yaqeen. He says, none of us will be missing to come with you. So my dear brothers, he says, if you take us to Barq al-Ghamad. Barq al-Ghamad is the Rub' al-Khali, a desert between Yemen and Saudi. No one can, if you cross that quarter of the desert, you die. It's very huge desert. He says, if you take us to Barq al-Ghamad, we will not delay by 1 second. So Rasulullah was very happy and he probably said them about it. In short, my dear brothers, because we are going to finish this year now, Allah bring the help, they got the victory. In the second year, this, the same year of Hijrah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they established the Masjid Nabawi, the Qibla was towards Masjid Al-Aqsa. After 10 months, it turned towards Mecca, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make compulsory the fasting of Ramadan in the second year of Hijrah and the Zakat. After that, my dear brothers, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the whole mushrikeen in the Jazeera try to, they want to fight him. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sending groups and he was sending people to the tribes. And in the Ghazwat al-Khandaq, Ghazwat al-Ahzab, in the year when the non-believers inside Mecca, Medina, and the mushrikeen and all the tribes gathered together to finish Rasulullah, Allah gave them victory. And after that victory, Rasulullah gave the promise to Sahaba that now none of the mushrikeen will come attacking you. You will be attacking them. This is when the turn starts. In the year, my dear brother, 6 after Hijrah, Rasulullah saw in a dream that he is making Umrah with his Sahaba. So he tells the dream to the Sahaba and they decide to go to Mecca to do Umrah. And they did not carry any weapon. And whatever sword they have, they put it in the small gallon of water. Or to make sure that they are not going to fight. And they took their camel and they make sanam. Sanam, it means the camels that they want slaughter for Allah, they hit it with the sword on the forehead and they put white clothes on the adab or the green clothes. As it's a sign that they are going to do Umrah and slaughter these camels for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give it to the poor of Mecca. So when Rasulullah reached Al-Hudaybiyah, the camels stop. So they said, Khala'at al-Qaswa. It means the Qaswa become disobedient. Rasulullah said, no, the Qaswa did not disobey, and this is not the khuluq, the behavior of this camel. But Allah stopped her as he stopped the camel, the elephant of Abraha. Because this is the Masjid Baytullah al-Haram. Allah doesn't want blood to be shed. So then he says, by Allah, if they agree with me in any agreement that they will have the greatness of the orders of Allah, I will do it with them. Listen to this. The agreement was looking like disgraceful to the Muslim, because this is how the agreement said. 10 years, no fight. 7 point, whosoever wants to accept any religion, he should accept it. 3rd point, which is very difficult, whosoever ran from the Muslim to the Mushrikeen, he will never return. And whosoever, whosoever ran from the Mushrikeen to Rasulullah among the Muslim, he should be returned back. So while they make this agreement, a son of Suhail ibn Amr was running. He just ran from a prison in Mecca with his chains. And when he ran, he came to the Muslim. So then Suhail said, this is the first one that I will ask to respect this point through him. So you have to return it back to me. So he says, give me permission. We are still did not sign. He says, no, then I will not make the agreement. So then he says, go back and be patient. So he got extremely angry. He says, how can I am under the punishment. How can you return me back to these non-believers? They will punish me more. So Rasulullah told him, be patient. In this point, Sahaba got extremely angry, especially Umar. So Umar radiallahu anhu went to Rasulullah and says, أَلَسْنَا عَلَى الْحَقِّ وَهُمْ عَلَى الْبَاطِلِ. Aren't we on the right and they are on the wrong? He says, yes. He says, فَلِمَا نُعْطِي الدَّنِيَّةَ فِي دِينِنَا. Why we should disgrace ourselves and accept such agreement? So Rasulullah told him, إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. I am the messenger of Allah. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ نَاصِرِي. And Allah will send me his help. So my dear brothers, this is what happened. Within 2 years, the number of the Muslims was 1,500. After 2 years, the number of Muslims became 10,000. 10,000. 7 years before, when they were fight, the Muslim jumped from 300 to 1,500, around 1,000. But 10 times more the number increase, through the peace agreement. What does it mean? It means the maqam of the da'wah in the Islam. Maqam of da'wah is very important. So my dear brothers, the Mushrikeen broke this agreement and they killed some Sahaba, and Rasulullah came to do opening of Mecca. After that, inshallah, my dear brothers, Sahaba, the all the idols, 360 idols, has been broke in Mecca. Bilal raised and called the Adhan, and Rasulullah did Umrah and he returned back. In the year 9, Rasulullah sent Abu Bakr Siddiq to do Hajj in his place, because a lot of tribe start coming and accept Islam, because they used to say, don't accept Islam now, wait. If this man is a liar, Allah will destroy him like he destroyed Abraham. But if he opened Mecca and Mecca become under his control, that means he is the messenger of Allah. So Arabs used to be smart. So when Rasulullah opened Mecca, destroyed the idols, and Mecca become Muslim, the tribes, they come by groups to accept Islam in Medina. So Rasulullah was very busy to talk to them about Islam, give them food, teach them, etc. So he sent Abu Bakr Siddiq for Hajj, and he sent Ali to give 4 announcements in the year 9. 4 announcements in the Maidan of Arab. The first announcement, لا يدخل الجنة كافر. A non-believer will never enter Jannah. Second announcement, لا يطوف بالبيت عريان. No one who should make tawaf in Kaaba naked, male or female. They used to do that in Jahiliyyah. 3rd announcement, whosoever has any agreement with Rasulullah for 6 months or 8 months or 1 year, his agreement is respected. And whosoever has no agreement with Rasulullah, he has 4 months to leave the Jazeera of Arab, or he must accept Islam. This is what Allah mentioned in Surah Tawbah. So after this Asmo announcement has been made, Abu Bakr Siddiq returned back, and then Rasulullah made the announcement that he's going to do Hajj, and he called all the tribe to come to with him. 124,000, the ulama, they said, witnessed the Hajj of Rasulullah, Hajjat al-Wada. And Rasulullah stand up in Maidan Arafah and did his khutbah. Everybody know khutbat al-Wada, khutbat Arafah. And among this khutbah, he explained all the details of Islam. After 2 months in Safar, when Rasulullah reached Medina, he feels so much pain in his head, and within few weeks in Rabi al-Awwal, the pain go throughout his body, and then he asked all his wife to give him permission to stay in Aisha radiallahu anha, and he asked Abu Bakr Siddiq to lead the Salat. And in Monday 12 Rabi al-Awwal, Rasulullah passed away, and he leave us on the deen of Islam. And Allah revealed the surah, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم.